Welcome to worship this morning at Sunbury Baptist. Glad that you've come. I hope that you come this morning with at least an anticipation of faith that you'll meet with the Lord, that you'll have an encounter with Jesus. This is where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in the midst. Sometimes we can come to church or we can be in the company of God's people and be in worship or praise and not have that sense that God was there, that His presence was there, because we're distracted or we have other things on our mind or we're just doing whatever we normally do. But I want to pray for you this morning. I want to pray for us. I want to pray for me that this morning our eyes will be opened, that we'll see in our spiritual, with our spiritual eyes, we'll see the presence of the Lord. We'll see His presence with us. We'll feel His Spirit moving amongst us, that we won't become so familiar with holy things that we forget that we're dealing with a holy God. We're dealing with a God who is personal. Father, we thank you this morning as we gather in the name of Jesus. We have a wonderful promise that those who do gather in your name, you are there in the midst. And we believe that's a very special promise. A promise for gatherings, a promise for the collecting of ourselves together around your throne of grace, around your presence that's in this place this morning. Give us humble hearts to receive, to hear, to obey, to do the things that you call us to have our eyes open that we might see Jesus. We thank you for this morning. We ask you that your blessing might be upon us, that we might be a blessing to others in turn. In Jesus' name. Amen. Stand and praise the Lord with me. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Bound and drenched in tears, they lay there.
Father, as long as we have breath, let us praise your name. As long as we have life, let us glorify you here on the earth. That by faith, that which we do not see, we proclaim as truth, we receive as a revelation from you, and respond to your glory, to your holiness, with praise and thanksgiving and honor to your name. We are your worshipers today, worshiping in spirit and truth, not just with the words of our mouths, but as a sacrifice, a living sacrifice to you. Accept us, Lord, as we present ourselves to you this morning in this act of worship. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said.
Amen. So, Father God, we thank you for the Lord Jesus who came into this world as Savior of the world. And, Lord, we just acknowledge that sometimes so many people are busy and they don't realize and recognize their need that they have for a Savior. But we thank you that we understand and know that we couldn't be here on our own. We couldn't do what we've done without you. And we thank you that we have eternity to look forward to because of what you have done for us. Lord, we just want to reflect on our country as well. We just pray that you would be with our leaders at different levels, for our Prime Minister and people in the Cabinet, those who are in Parliament who represent us, those here at the state level, the Premier and the Parliament again. We pray that each one might reflect on their responsibility and duty to represent the people and to work in integrity. We pray that you would just give them wisdom and that they might have a heart for the poor and the needy, and to make a society that reflects the character that you would have us reflect. Lord, we pray for our city of Hume as well. We pray that you would just guide the councillors and those who are involved, that we might be a city that supports those that are in need, and that provides an environment that allows families to live in peace and to flourish. Lord, we pray for our community here at Sunbury Baptist. We thank you for Paul and Dawn and the work that they do here at Sunbury Baptist. We pray that you would continue to encourage them and inspire them and fill them with your spirit as they do so much for us as part of this church. We thank you for those who contribute in so many different ways and ministries, and who just organize us and bring things along and lead. We think of Rosie and Jill and SBC Kids at the moment, that you would just guide them as they put together a bit of a Christmas program, that that the name of your Savior, the Lord Jesus, might be honored amongst those children, and that they might have a deep understanding of who you are and why you came into this world. Lord, we thank you for you being a Savior. And Lord, we recognize that there's lots of darkness around, and sometimes people they see the darkness but don't realize that there is a Savior who is there to bring joy to them, a Savior who's there to bind up the brokenhearted, and a Savior who's there to free those who are captive to different things, to release them from darkness, to give them a real sense of beauty, that they've been made in your image and likeness, that they might have the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of heaviness. Lord, we thank you for who you are and what you mean to us, and help us to be your ambassadors, to be your witness, your agents in this society, and to bring the good news of a Saviour to this world. Lord, we pray that you would work amongst our families and bring those who don't know you into your family, that they might come to understand, maybe through something that how we live, that you love them and you are desperate that they come to know you as Saviour. So, Father, we thank you for this day. We pray that you would just bless the service as Paul opens the word to us, as we sing songs, that your name might be lifted high and your presence be honored amongst us today. We commit ourselves to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning, we want to encourage you to worship the Lord. You can't force anyone to worship God, but we want to encourage you. So the words we've chosen, the songs we've chosen, are just about blessing the Lord and acknowledging his presence and worshiping him. Now, I believe the Lord's here with us. I can't prove it, because it could be any group of people sitting inside a room somewhere. Can't prove the Lord's here. But one of our songs that we're going to sing today is Open the Eyes of My Heart. And I'm hoping it's your prayer this morning, because there's nothing you can do to open your own eyes. You can't make your eyes to see anything. But to have your eyes open this morning to see Jesus would be a wonderful thing. It'd be a miracle of restored sight, or of sight in the first place. You've never seen Jesus before. You've never seen his glory. You've never seen what he can do. So, Come with me and worship the Lord.
Blessed are those who run to him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake them. Blessed are those who seek his face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your
your glory. Come on and pray.
falling. Bless God, cause he goes before me. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God, for he holds the victory. Bless God, for he's always with me. Bless God, for he's always ready. Every chance I get, I bless your name. I bless your name. Every chance I get, come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your voice with me. He's ready of all.
Shining in the light of your glory.
to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy.
Stand in your presence, Lord. You're a holy God. You're a holy God. Somehow you welcome us. Somehow you made it possible for us to come. Stand in your presence today, on this day, in your holy presence. What can we say? What more can we offer you, Lord? For praise that belongs to you, that comes from us, is for our good. Because we need to praise you. We need to worship you.
Be still for the presence of the Lord. The Holy One is here. In him no sin is found.
trust that you know the truth of what we are singing. I remember years ago, you know, we used to sing Refine as Fire. We sometimes sing it again, but it used to be very popular, Refine as Fire. And, you know, we'd sing Purify My Heart, Lord, let it be as gold, and, you know, etc. And then I was having a bit of a whinge to a brother about how tough things were going, and he looked at me and said, "Don't you sing that song, Refine as Fire?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "What do you expect, a Bunsen burner or a crucible? What were you expecting?" Fair enough. It's what you sing sometimes is also how the Lord responds. He sees our hearts. And I'm going to read to you from John chapter 9. And typically, we take a passage and preach on a verse. And in the Puritan tradition, they'd write a whole book on one verse or one part of a verse. But I'm actually going to read the whole of this chapter, because I think that John, in writing it, writes it as one whole story. There's parts that we could focus on. Obviously, it's going to come to our attention just as we focus a little bit, but I want to read the whole story, and it is 41 verses, but again, it's scripture, so you'll be blessed if you hear the word of the Lord. John chapter 9 and verse 1. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I'm in the world, I am the light of the world." After saying this, he spat on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes opened?" they asked. He replied, "The man they called Jesus made some mud, put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed, and then I could see." "Where is this man?" they asked him. I don't know, he said. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man replied, "and I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others asked, "How can a sinner perform such signs?" So they were divided. Then they turned again to the blind man. "What have you to say about him?" "It was you, he opened the eyes." The man replied, "He is a prophet." They still did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight, until they sent for the man's parents. "Is this your son?" they asked. "Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that now he can see?" "We know he's our son," the parents answered, "and we know that he was born blind, but how he can see or who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him, he's of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders who had already decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. That was why the parents said, "He's of age, ask him." The second time they summoned the man who had been blind. "Give glory to God by telling the truth," they said. "We know this man is a sinner." He replied, "Whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see." Then they asked him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" And he answered, "I've told you already, and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" Then they hurled insults at him and said, "You are this fellow's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but as for this fellow, we don't know where he comes from." The man answered, "Now that's remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly person who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this were not from God, he could do nothing." To this they replied, "You were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us?" And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Who is he, sir?" the man asked. "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." Then the man said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshipped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I've come into this world, so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind." Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, "What? Are we blind too?" Jesus said, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you see, your guilt remains." Who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Can you imagine that question in today's culture? Man has a disability from birth, and we're asking who sinned? I mean, just hear it in our culture, right? It sort of clashes, doesn't it? I mean, the first thing you'd get is hate speech, even for asking the question. We wouldn't ask such a question. In fact, we find these days that there is an identity based on where we're at and what happened to us and what kind of disability we have. It's sort of so much a part of our life and so much wanting acceptance for those things, whether it's a choice we make about life or whether it's a disability, that becomes part of our identity. And for someone to question that might be based on or caused by or be the result of sin is actually, can you hear that? Like, would you risk that publicly? Would you dare to suggest that someone had sinned and therefore they were blind? So you got to understand the worldview of the Jewish people. The disciples were part of their worldview. In fact, the biblical worldview is far more about curse of sin and blessing of righteousness than we would actually encounter in our culture, because basically our culture's turned its back on God anyway. We've decided that we can make our own righteousness and we make our own blessing, and we even hear about people saying, I just had to go out and create my own identity. Well, what a fallacy that is. How do you create your own identity when God made you in his own image and created you for a purpose? You're his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for a life of good works which he has prepared beforehand for you to walk in. You are who you are because he made you. Sometimes we might blame parents for genetic defects, and that's another issue, or for the way in which things that happen during pregnancy, but still we would really struggle with this whole question. In the biblical worldview, though, Jesus actually denied that it was either this man's sin or his parents' sin. He wasn't denying that there was sin in the world. He wasn't denying that they were actually part of a sinful, broken world. He just said they're not personally responsible for the fact this man is born blind. In fact, there's a reason he was born blind, and God is going to use that purpose. God is going to manifest his glory. I am the light of the world. I am the one who's come into the world to do the works of the Father, and you will see those things in this man because God will be glorified in him. You see, Jesus wasn't going to allow more guilt and shame to be heaped on this man. He wasn't going to allow more condemnation to be landed on this blind man who had sat there in his blindness since his birth. And he had actually been a beggar most of his life. That's how he made a living. Everybody knew that this man was a blind man who sat and begged. That was his identity. But one day Jesus came by. The Bible doesn't say that he interacted with the man, that he asked him a question, like this blind Bartimaeus. You remember Bartimaeus on the road to Jericho, and he yells out, "Son of David, Son of David, have mercy on me." And they tried to shut him up, and he yelled all the more. And Jesus comes over, and this man wasn't yelling, wasn't asking, just as Jesus came by and he saw this blind man. His disciples asked a question, and there was a discussion taking place. And I don't know if you realize how acute the hearing of blind people is. I remember a friend of mine, Peter Summers, after he lost his eyesight due to an accident, he fell off a ladder with lime washing his garage, and the lime wash fell in his eyes and it blinded him. And he said he was standing in a lift one time, and the person next to him says, what floor does he want to get off on? He says, I'm blind, not deaf. I can actually hear what you're saying. And I imagine this blind man could hear the conversation that was going on around him as Jesus spoke to his disciples and said, neither this man nor his parents have sinned and caused this, but that the manifest glory of God might be seen today. I might have given him some hope. But the next thing is kind of a mystery. It's kind of an interesting sort of thing, isn't it, that Jesus takes, he spits in the ground, takes mud and puts it in his eyes. How many of you ever tried that as a healing balm? Ever tried that as a method of ministering to people? Let me just minister to you and then take the mud and put it in his eyes. The only time I can remember people spitting at me was when I was a preschooler in a place called Chincha in Ethiopia. And these were lovely ladies on their way to market, older ladies. And I was a cute little white fella, little white boy. Yeah, cute as anything, you know. Funny, because I was one of the unique, you know, there weren't many around. There was only a couple of us in the whole district. So just being white was a novelty. So these women would come over and they'd say these cooing words in their language. And I understood some of Amharic, but they spoke a tribal dialect and they all looked friendly. And then suddenly they'd spit at you. And I still remember thinking that was unusual. I didn't understand, though, that they were spitting because they were avoiding the evil eye. I was different. I was someone different. They didn't quite understand, and so they spat in order to avoid the evil eye. Now, I can't remember it ever hitting me, but it was the thought of it. And I think of this man sitting by the roadside, and I think of perhaps people who would have spat in the dirt and cursed him because he was blind, and there must have been some problem there. And Jesus took that very spittle, as it were, the very curse that was on him, the very thing that had caused him such shame, and took it and put it on his eyes and said, now go and wash in the pool of Siloam. I wonder if you've ever thought, if your eyes have never worked, how would you know you're blind? Have you ever thought about that? How did this man find out that he was blind? He didn't have any previous experience of seeing. No one, you know, he wouldn't have known except someone must have indicated to him, you're blind, right? Someone must have told him they can, and he discovered pretty soon that people could do things around him that he couldn't do. They would say, look at me, and say, what does that mean? So, well, there's a tree over there. Well, I don't know if that's true. Well, come with me. And it's like this, and this is what it looks like. When you get over there, sure enough, as he feels it, it's exactly the way it was described to him. So eventually he does come to the realization that he's blind. The man didn't ask Jesus for his sight, and he certainly didn't ask for mud in the eye. He didn't ask for the treatment that he got, but he had a choice to make. When Jesus stopped, spat on the ground and put mud in his eyes, this man had a choice to make. His faith began by hearing what Jesus had to say. His faith began when Jesus told him to do something that was unusual, out of the ordinary, didn't make sense, wasn't necessarily logical, but he had a choice to make. He could believe and go, just say, okay, get up. He'd have to get led there. He wouldn't be able to find his own way necessarily, unless he'd been to the Pool of Siloam many times, in which case he would know the route, how many steps it was, and which way you turn. More than likely, he would be led to the Pool of Siloam. But that was a choice he had, believe and go. Or he could say, yes, I believe what you're saying is true. Thank you, Jesus. Really appreciate you stopping by today. And by the way, thanks for the mud in the eye too. Or he can simply say, I'm not going to go, I don't believe. But the only thing that saved him, the only thing that gave him his eyesight, was the faith that said, I hear what Jesus said, I go and do it. It was a faith that said, I believe enough to do what you're telling me to do. That's what his faith meant to him. Remember, this man was a blind man. He didn't see Jesus. He didn't see the man who was talking to him. He didn't really know who he was, as we find out later in the story. But this man chose to act in faith. He chose to obey the word of God. He chose to take what was given to him and act on it. And because of that, he received a miracle. A lot of people want all the arguments for being a Christian, for being a follower of Jesus, laid out for them in such a logical, convincing manner that if you convince me, if you can prove it to me, if you can make it true to me, and if you can convince me, then I'll follow Jesus. It's like, you know, you give me all the answers first, you let me see the outcome, and then I'll decide whether I believe or not. But faith begins at the point where you're humble enough to say, I have heard from Jesus, and I'm going to act on that. But I don't think Jesus does it any other way, because when you see it right throughout Scripture, as he calls people to follow him, they don't hardly know who he is. As they start to hear the call on their life, they begin to follow. And he reveals more and more and more as they follow, as they obey, as they come with him. That's the same for us. This man's miracle took place on the Sabbath, which was a bit of a problem. Apparently, it's a religious problem. See, the real blindness in this story isn't the man born blind, it's the people who opposed him. The real blindness of this story is not that he was a man born blind and it's such a tragedy and it's an incapacity and it's something that shouldn't happen. And you know, we live in a fallen world where this is the reality for us. And of course, this has a moral to it beyond just the physical. It's a spiritual blindness that we're all born into. We don't see the glory of God. We don't see his glory. How many of you know the name David Attenborough? Because David Attenborough is one of those guys who has studied this world we live in, this planet, in such great depth. The animals and the birds and the insects and the waves and the planet and the weather and the systems. And you just sit back and you think. And then he says, all this evolved. And you think, you don't get it, do you? You don't get it. The very things you see with your eyes, you don't see with your heart. You don't see the Creator who has manifested his power and glory by giving us all these things on this planet. And yet we go searching the universe to see if there's a sign of life. And on Mars, we see some little streak in a rock and think, oh, there could be life there. When there's life right here, abundantly around us in such amazing detail and such amazing creativity. There's a God behind that. There's a spiritual blindness. There's a blindness in our community that should never be. A spiritual blindness. The Bible says that we are all sinners. We've been born into sin. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. He said, well, it's not my fault. Not my parents' fault. No. It goes right back to the beginning. The biblical context is that we have fallen from God's grace and glory. We've fallen from his purpose. We've fallen from seeing, hearing, understanding, walking with the Father in the garden, walking with God on a daily basis in his creation, being one with him, one with each other, and at one with the creation he gave us to care for. We've fallen a long way from that. This man was born blind and he got to see because he acted in faith. And then he had another problem, because he got interrogated for why it happened on the Sabbath. And the assumption was, if this happened on the Sabbath, it can't be of God. At that moment, the parents kind of took a back step, didn't they? They said, well, hey, don't ask us. We don't want to get thrown out of the synagogue here. We don't want to risk your ire and your rejection. Just go and ask the man. He's old enough. He's of age. You know, he possibly 40 years old, whatever he was. Ask him. So he come to the man and said, what do you say? He said, well, one thing I do know. This morning I was sitting by the road begging. I was blind and now I'm looking at you and I see. They even questioned whether he's the same man. He says, well, as far as I know, I am, because I went to the pool and now my eyes are opened. You can believe me or not believe me. And then they ask the parents, they come back to tell us about how it happened. He says, didn't I just tell you? Haven't I just spoken? Haven't I just given my testimony? And you haven't believed me? And then they start accusing him of being a disciple of Jesus. Now, be careful when people accuse you of being a disciple of Jesus, because if you're not one, you're going to be in trouble, right? But if you are one, you're still going to be in trouble. But they accused him of being a disciple of Jesus when they were disciples of Moses. And the man said, I don't know if he's a sinner or not, but this I know. Once I was blind, but now I see. And if he's a prophet of God, then God did this. And for that, he got thrown out of the synagogue. He got rejected. And he meets Jesus. And Jesus asks him the question, says, do you believe in the Son of Man? And this man's open now. He's in no man's land. He's had a miracle of sight. He's had this grace given to him, this miracle that's opened his physical eyes. And he discovered that the Pharisees are blinder than he was. And he doesn't know where to go. And he meets Jesus and Jesus asks him, do you believe in me? Lord, show me who is the Son of Man? I am the one that's talking to you. It says in verse 38, he says, I believe. And he fell down and worshipped Jesus. He became a follower of Jesus that day. See, the miracle was that his eyesight was open, but the deeper miracle was that he saw Jesus and became a follower. Some of you know the story of Fanny Crosby, who lost her eyesight. But she was one of the most profound hymn writers ever. And people used to say, oh, wouldn't it be great if God gave you a miracle of eyesight? She says, but I've seen things that I would never have seen. I've seen things that I never would have seen. And one day my eyesight will be restored. But I've seen God's glory. I wonder this morning whether you can see or not. Now, some of you may never have seen the Lord in this way. We've seen the glory of God, seen his kingdom, seen that invitation of Jesus, that your eyes, not just your physical eyes, but I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the eyes of your heart, the eyes of your spirit, that you might see and behold Jesus as Lord. That's the purpose of the gospel. The whole purpose of the gospel is to reveal Jesus, to make this Jesus known. Someone said, asked the question, how could a few hours of one man dying on a cross, even though he suffered terribly, how could one man's suffering for a few hours on a cross redeem the whole world, all of mankind, for all ages? And the answer was, you need to know who the man was. You need to know who the man was. That man, Jesus, is the Son of God. And his life and his suffering is sufficient for all humanity to be saved. And that's the invitation for you and for me, to come to Jesus. Now, I suspect in talking to the church that I know pretty well, and most of you who've confessed your faith in different ways and you've acknowledged that Jesus Christ is your Lord, and you've said, oh, I'm baptized, I'm a member, or I'd like to be a member, or I'd like to be baptized. Whether you attend church or not, it's not what we're talking about. But I believe that sometimes as Christians, as followers of Jesus, we get cataracts in our spiritual eyes. Can I say that? I said to her, you're over 80, you don't wear glasses. And she says, I've had my cataracts done. Now, you know, I don't know whether I need to have it done or not. But I only wear these things to read, but I can't see what I'm reading unless I have these glasses on. So I don't know whether that's cataracts or not. Probably not. I don't know what it is. But I do know that my eyesight isn't what it used to be. It just has been fading over time. Right? So what does that mean spiritually? How does that work for us spiritually? I think sometimes as believers, we get into certain habits and behaviors and patterns that make us very familiar with the things that we're doing. We go to church regularly or in a certain pattern, every second week or third week or every week. And we do certain things, even quiet times, you know, times alone, we pray or we read or whatever. And we just do it regularly. We do it so regularly. We do it in such a way. Or whatever the pattern is, and I just want to challenge you a little bit to say, are you seeing Jesus in your spirit? Are you seeing him with fresh and clear eyes? Do you see him? Do you need to pray that prayer, open the eyes of my heart, Lord, that I might see you in your glory? I don't want the church to become ho-hum about God, about Jesus. I don't want us to become so familiar that we lose the wonder of who it is that we're looking at. John spent all of his discipleship with Jesus in the early part of his time with Jesus, when Jesus was on the earth. He spent it walking with Jesus. He shared the same accommodation, shared meals with him, and he knew him very well. He was surprised, with, like the other disciples, when Jesus died, and even more surprised when he rose again from the dead, and he beheld him. He was one of the three that beheld his glory up on Mount of Transfiguration. He saw what the future glory of Jesus was, who he really was. He saw all that. But in Revelation it says, he heard a voice behind him. He turned and saw the glory of the Son of God. And you remember the story, the picture in Revelation 1 of the hair and the band and the gold and the glory of God. And he fell down as though dead. He fell down. What happened to John? Did he lose something? No. He had a level of seeing that he hadn't seen before. He had a level of perception and revelation that he had. His eyes were open to see even more of who Jesus really is. And I want to encourage you. I want to almost, as it were, invite you. Now, I'm not going to put mud in your eye to get this done, okay? I'm not going to put mud in your spiritual eyes either. I don't have a mechanism for this except to say that I want you to see Jesus. And I want to be one that sees him more clearly. So if you've never seen Jesus, today I want to invite you to come. We'll pray for you. Come to the front. We will pray that you will see. Your eyes will be open. You say, I've never known Jesus as Lord. I've never known what it is to confess Jesus as Lord and to own him as Lord of my life. I've been in church. I've done all the right things. I've tried to walk the walk. I've tried to talk the talk. But I actually want to see who Jesus is. And by the way, it can't happen without the Holy Spirit. So you're really asking, Holy Spirit, come, open my eyes, fill my heart. Let me see Jesus. Because seeing Jesus, Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you've seen me, if you've understood who I am, if your eyes have been opened to see me, Philip, you wouldn't be asking about the Father, because you have seen him, you have known him, because I have revealed him to you. That's the Jesus we worship. The foundation of all things, the one in whom and through whom and for whom all things were created. Without him, nothing was created. This is the God we worship through Jesus. And I invite you to come. And I don't know whether this is something you need to do today. If it is, I do want you to make a stand and say, I want to have my eyes opened. I've walked away. My eyes have become dulled. I know I haven't seen the glory of Jesus. I know I've let tragedy. I know I've let circumstance. I know I've let sadness. I know I've let the world. I've even got my eyes on other things, and I haven't seen Jesus in all his glory. The one who gives me hope. The one who says, no matter what happens, I am with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. If you believe in me, you will never die but have everlasting life. This is the Jesus I want you to see. Not the circumstances, not the things that have caused the dullness of your seeing, but to see Jesus. And if you want to see him in that way, as the Lord of your life, I want you to come. And as we sing this last song, I want you to come and just come as you are. Come as you are and say, Lord, here I am. I don't want you to think about what people think. I want you to think about what Jesus will think. Because right now, your heart is either stirring up within you because the Holy Spirit is saying it's you. It's you I want to open the eyes of. It's you I want to anoint with my spirit. I want to put that healing balm on your spiritual eyes so that you have clarity. You see and you know and understand who I am. And you hear. See, one of the things that's lost in the sinful world in which we live, and it happened in the Garden of Eden, is that after hearing, seeing and walking with God in the garden, Adam and Eve lost that capacity. They sinned and there was a barrier between them and God. It didn't mean he stopped caring. It didn't mean that he stopped revealing himself. It just that they didn't have that intimacy. And the whole of the story of the Old Testament then coming and culminating in Jesus is restoring that which was lost through the sinfulness and the rebellion and the hardness of heart and the blindness. The Bible says the God of this world has blinded the eyes of unbelievers. You need a miracle to see. I can't work miracles, but I know someone who can. And he will do that today for you if you'll ask him. If you'll humble yourself and say, Lord, here I am. Open my eyes. Take away the cataracts. Take away the dullness of my seeing. Open my ears, Lord, that I might hear your voice. I've grown up reading the Bible. My first Bible, I think, when I was 5, when I was at the boarding school. Doesn't mean if I read the Bible, it's the same as hearing God's voice. It's a great place to go, by the way. It's a great place to go, and you'll be enriched by it, and God will speak to you, but you need to understand. I can have fellowship with Tolkien by reading Lord of the Rings. I get to know a bit of his mindset, a bit. I don't know, not quite understand Tolkien, no matter what I read, but do you know what I mean? Get to know him. Read the author. I sort of have fellowship with C.S. Lewis because I read some of his books. A.W. Tozer, what a great man of God. But I have a personal relationship with any of those people. I don't commune with them. They don't speak to me apart from what's written. And I don't want you to see Jesus as just the author of the book. I want you to see him as Lord and Savior in your life. I don't want you to see him as just someone who's recorded history so that you could know more about him the more you read. I want you to hear him speak to you. I want you to know that Jesus comes to you to take away your blindness, to open the eyes of your heart. That's my prayer for you today. And to me, that's what Christmas is about. It's the coming of the Savior into the world, that we might have fellowship with the Father restored. Let's pray. The band can come up. Father, this morning, there may be someone here, maybe just one person, who needs a miracle. Mm-hmm. And they're humble enough to ask. And if there's even one person, Lord, you'd not reject them. And if no one responds today, Lord, you know their hearts. You know the hearts of everyone else. Nothing's hidden from you. You know what our needs are. I pray that this word, which, if any of it is from you, Lord, as we've read and thought about what Jesus is and who he is, if any of that finds a place in the hearts of people who've been listening today or even on video, that you will cause it to bring fruit to yourself. Glorify yourself, Lord. Open the eyes of the blind. Cause us who have perhaps a dullness of eye. We've seen before, we've known before, we've heard before. But we need to see again. We need the spiritual eyes open, not just glasses put on us, but the eyes renewed and refashioned, as it were, and connected to the reality of who you are. Let the light of the world shine upon us here in this place today, we pray. In Jesus' name.
Just as I am.
I think sums it up, doesn't it? Just as I am, poor, wretched, blind, sight, riches, healing of the mind. Yes, all in, yea, all I need in thee to find, O Lamb of God, I come. Son of God, Jesus Christ, Lamb of God, we come to you as a people. We come to you humbly and we ask you to open the eyes, open our hearts to receive what you want to impart, to take from us those things which hinder our sight and our hearing, to remove every spot, every unclean thing, every shameful, guilty thing that persists in our lives, and let your light shine upon us. Set us free in Jesus' name. Grant to us that grace which comes by hearing and obeying your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.